brother. First off, how do we sound on your side, brother?
You sound great. And I appreciate the amazing comments. It's an honor to be here, to be in front of you guys, and to be able to participate in your class today.
Christian, before I start anything, it's the year 2016, and I have to do a selfie, brother, if I could with you. Ha ha ha! become pro. When did that start, brother? Were you 14, 15? When you saw that huge fame in your life, when you were, you know, doing the famous stuff?
I think everything starts with a dream. You know, it doesn't matter what age you are, it matters of what your goals are.
And when I discovered skateboarding, after I was going to be Bruce Lee, obviously, that was my first goal, was I was going to be Bruce Lee, I was going to be on TV, and I was going to make fun of everybody while I did it, and wear no shirt, and look as cool as Bruce did, but when I got introduced to skateboarding, it was like I fell in love with something that was so connected to where I was living, the people I was hanging out with, my father, who was a surfer in the 50s and 60s in Hawaii,
and
part of the whole sidewalk surf era, 70s, and then the Jay Adams, Tony Alva show, all that happened right here in California, and I ended up growing up right here, and that resonated with me, and it became the dream that I had when I was probably about 7, 8 years old. I was looking at the magazines, and I was like, this is it for me. This is what I'm going to be. I'm going to be the Bruce Lee, Elvis Presley, the Clint Eastwood of skateboarding, because those were my three idols. I've watched movies, and I've listened to the music, and I just imagined myself being that cool. And so when skateboarding came in, I was like, this is insane. I could really, you know, see doing. And it starts there. I think everything starts with a dream. I mean, a lot of people do life and they just kind of aim aimlessly without really having a goal. I always try to encourage kids, especially if not young, older people as well, to set a goal and then to, you know, count the steps that it takes to get there. And for me, it was about being the best in the world. I said, okay, how am I going to be the best in the world? Well, I need to practice. Well, I need to go to the skate park, and that means I need to practice. And then, you know, my father noticed, he said, you know what, you really want to do this all the time. And so he was like, it's too expensive to pay for this 2-hour sessions every weekend, and now I want to go every day. It was expensive, and he's like, I'm going to manage the skate park. And that's when the skate park became my backyard, which was Marina Del Rey. And that's where I really could skate 8 hours a day if I wanted to. And that's what I did. It's like school, you know, people who want to succeed in education, they just knock it out. They go as much as they can, and they get it done as fast as they can, so that they can move on to the next level. And it's the same thing with anything in your life. Whatever you want to do, whatever you want to be, it just takes you to have a goal. And nothing was going to get in between me and reaching those goals, and so I was... Say 10, skate park first time to turning pro, winning the biggest amateur contest at 12, turning pro at 14, and on my way to becoming a world champion at probably around 16. And that was how long it takes. You know what I mean? It doesn't happen overnight because I wanted it. It took a lot of determination, a lot of perseverance, and a lot of just, you know, and skateboarding wasn't your popular thing like it is now. Skateboarding was like a bunch of punks, rebels. We were considered outcasts. We were definitely partiers. We were definitely, you know, raging. You know, I mean, my idols were Jay Adams and Tony Alva. What did they do? Drop out of school, do drugs, hang out and drink beer, look for girls. I mean, that was it. So what did I end up being? Became just like that. But in the end, it led me on a course of, you know, where all the priorities were to be the best in the world, to win world championships, to invent maneuvers, and yes, Christ, there, Rocky, there, all these maneuvers I invented.
He created them.
But also, you know, peer pressure to have to fit in. And it's the same thing in school, you know, where your people group, wherever you grow up, your neighborhood, that people say, and there's always the cool kids, you know what I mean, you want to be a part of, but they're doing things that, you know, can steer you off course of your goals and what your dreams are. And that's really what happened to me. I mean, it happened after I became a world champion, because here we are, our second
run. Now X Games are coming in 95. I was a world champion in 83.
And Chris was, now you were world champion back then. And, but I made that mention of Tony Hawk earlier. You were beating Tony Hawk in the competitions. In the video we saw, Rising Sun, Tony's talking all about you, you know? Ladies and gentlemen, just to put that out there for Christian Hosoi, this is the man that skateboarding has built itself from in the 1980s. But Chris also has a story. He wasn't handed all of these accolades. Christian's gonna get to the point when he found himself in prison walls. And that story's crazy when you hear what Christian was trying to do. But we have to realize, we have to ask.
Where the pressures of life come in and can snuff out dreams, snuff out goals, and you can steer off course because there's a lot of things that seem, you know, right, feel right, and will give you what you want for the temporary, you know, pleasures of life. But when you're set out on a goal to achieve something, you have to keep your eyes focused on that prize, because if you don't, I see so many skateboarders today and people in life that have such gifting, such talents. Like, I wish I could be them so that I could take my mind and my passion and just say, let me have your body and your talent for a minute and see what I can do with it, because it's just going to waste, because they're cluttered, they don't have any mentors in their life, they don't have any people they look up to that have reached the goals where they're headed for. And I think that's, you know, for today, you got to really attach to the people you want to be like, because you're only gonna really be like who you look up to. You know what I mean? And you want to be like them. I wanted to be like my mentors and my idols, and I ended up being just like them. But you know, with the peer pressures of life, I tell you, it was hard for me to resist the temptation of drugs and partying to the point where I ended up going to prison for 5 years over it. But, you know, I don't regret anything, because I am still alive today here talking with you guys on Skype, sharing my story of trial and error, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that that's something that, you know, the experience of life is something that you can't buy.
Mm-hmm.
So now you guys can vicariously take what I've done wrong and not do it, versus you have to go out and attempt it yourself, because I thought it was going to be good. So I ended up figuring it out that it wasn't, and it was unhealthy for me, took me off course, took me from being highlighted to go to the X Games in 95 to just going into full-blown drug addiction, because I was like, skateboarding's, like, lame now, it's not cool anymore, you know, your ego gets in the way, next thing you know, I was, well, you know, I'll always be the best, you know what I mean, I was thinking on those lines, not thinking of what I could continue to do to you know, keep skateboarding authentic, respectful, to keep it, you know, in the direction that I feel that it should go in, kind of like being an ambassador for the sport, kind of like I am today.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it all leads up to, like, the individuals.
Hosoi Skateboards, brothers, and I want to go into what you did with branding Hosoi Skateboards. One of the most recognized skateboard businesses, companies around. But before I go there, Chris, bro, I gotta ask you, brother, like, you know, and there's a whole side of the room with students that you can't see either. Chris, Paul, guys, I got a short wire, so I'm trying to spin it around. But the idea of drugs, my man, it's something that guys like us seen through the 1980s, 90s, and we've seen the lack of that. You felt it, brother. But we have a lot of students in here that may be 18, 19, upwards of 30. So between the 18 and 30 mark. My question is this, brother. There's a lot of pressure on these young men and women to either go out and, you know, be part of this crowd of, you know, whether it's drinking, whether it's drugging. My boy, listen, you are a legend, my man. You're a Hall of Famer. You've actually changed the world. I want to ask you, what advice do you have for this crew? And I'm nobody in my scholars to say what I'm about to do at all.
Well, I have to say, normal culture to go out, get drunk, to fall over, to, you know, have a fun time on the weekend. But at the end of the day, it's steering your dreams off course, because they're putting them on pause, they're putting them on hold, and you're not reaching your full capacity. And I realized that in hindsight, looking back, that I could have been much more than I was. But, you know, because of my talent and my gifting, I was able to maintain a certain, you know, level of talent to be able to still be a world champion, even though I was doing those things, which I can only imagine what I could have done if I was, say, you know, focused on progression, taking skateboarding to the next level. Thinking like outside the box, like Danny Wade did when he created the mega ramp, where he's doing 30-foot airs, you know, 20-foot airs out of a 30-foot quarter pipe. Why didn't we think about that? Well, I was too busy partying. I was too busy being like the guy, going out to clubs and really thinking, all right, I've done enough. I've done as much as I can, and no one's gonna touch that. Well, you know, those things can. You know, I'm fortunate that I didn't OD or die or never succeed because, you know, it's by the mercy, I always say it's the mercy of God that I'm still here. Like, tomorrow's not promised, and I know that now. But back then, I was like, just here to succeed, here to do what I can, do whatever I can, and try to be as nice a person as I can. And hopefully more people will like me. I just try to jump through the hoops of life. Kind of like what most people do when they try to fit into their neighborhood, their friends, their cliques, you know, and you want to be popular. I mean, there's nothing wrong with being popular. It's just a matter, is it, it's going to take you off course of your goal.
Chris.
And I think that that's where, you know, people who stay focused on who they want to be, not just who they are the ones that are going to push through that and not allow that to take them off course and to really quench the dream that's in your heart. Because, you know, it's easy. Money can quench your dream. Girls can quench your dream. Guys can quench your dreams for the girls. And next thing you know, you're like, man, it's too late. Well, it's never too late. It's just a matter of you want to connect to that dream again. Because look it up. I got out of prison. I was like 38 years old. I thought my life was kind of over in a sense when I started the prison sentence because I got like 10 years. They said I was going to do 10 years.
What happened, Chris?
And
what
they said
got
I was
going to
do 6 years, and then I ended up doing 5.
Chris, what got you there, brother? What got you to the prison jail?
What's that?
What was it, my brother, that sadly landed you, my brother, in that prison? What did you do, kiddo?
Oh, well, I mean, I just was addicted to crystal meth for about eight years straight, and ended up carrying a whole bunch on an airplane thinking, I've been to Hawaii a million times on an airplane, never been searched before, they'll never search me. I'm gonna go out there and I'm gonna party, and I said, tomorrow I'm gonna quit. How many, you know, of us say tomorrow, I'm gonna quit, or tomorrow, I'm gonna start working on my dream, tomorrow, I'm gonna finish school, tomorrow, you know, and you get stuck in this rut, and I was stuck in such a deep rut that there was no way out for me other than to get busted. And I ended up getting busted at the airport and them telling me I'm doing all this time, and I had to reevaluate my life. And at that moment, you know, I had no choice. See, all of you guys have a choice whether to go to school or not, whether you want to go home or not, whether you want to go to a public restaurant or not. See, I had no more choices in that. And I think that that's where, you know, me being a kid that traveled the world 20 times and was a world champion, had millions of dollars and went to the best places and met all the best people. But here I am, all my lines were cut. Nowhere to go, no, you know, can't call a lawyer, a business person, can't buy my way out of that cell. And I had to reevaluate my life, and that's where, you know, I was able to let the smoke clear and me to actually really see what I've done in the past, the accomplishments that I've even achieved to that point, to see what I can do in the future. And at that moment, I was like, wait a minute. I can use my life now of my rights and wrongs to help other people. And God put that in my heart. It wasn't like I had read a book. It was like God really said, I love you, Christian, and I've always loved you, and I've had a plan for your life. It's just you chose to live your own life yourself. And so then I just studied Bible, got into courses, and I took advantage of my time. I didn't allow time to take advantage of me, and I spent that whole 5 years in prison studying to be able to come out and not get swallowed up by the world again, and to get back into drug addiction, or to be all about my self-centeredness, and to be all about the money or the fame again. And when I came out, it was all about, what can I do to help people? How can I serve other people? How can I encourage people to not go down those dark roads that I went down? And so that's been my purpose, is to use all my wrongs, all the wrong choices, all the mess ups, to hopefully, you know, turn it into a message for other people so that they can draw from, they can gain wisdom from, they can, you know, be inspired from, like, you know, me just saying, hey, your goals, your dreams, and you may have one, but you're sitting there going, you know what, I forgot about it. Oh, you know what, I'm too old for that. Oh, yeah, I'm too young to even think about that. You know what, you're never too young, too old, it's never too late. I think that it's just a matter of sheer desire, passion, and will to want to fulfill the things that I always say what God puts in your heart, because if it's not a sin, well, then I believe it can be God's inspired dream in you. And when it has to do with fun, enjoyment, encouraging others, teaching, leading, guiding, protecting the future generations, I think that it's nothing but good.
Yeah.
And so now, you know, I'm out, been out 12 years, this June.
Right, applause.
I've been clean and sober for 16 and a half years.
Yes, you know. That's what's up, brother. That's what's up, baby.
And it's not because I'm a good person. It's just because I love the Lord, and, you know, and I know what He's done for me. You know, I'm a pastor now at the Sanctuary Church in Orange County. I travel around the world, but I also go around speaking to schools, and I get to inspire students, young people like yourselves, to desire, to have passion about what they want to do. And you have to choose. You can't just sit here and aim in the air and expect to hit a target, you know. And even like when I want to do questions with you guys so that you guys can interact with me, is that you guys can really aim for something versus just, I'm just going to try something. And, you know, time flies by really fast. And I've learned, because I'm old now. I'll be 49 this year.
Ah, oh, you're young, Chris. Get out of here. You're so young, bro.
I know I look probably about, you know, 23, but... took $20,000 cash, took it down to the to the board manufacturer. Me and my father, we hand screened the boards ourselves in a garage.
Yeah.
And that was the beginning of the company. And it's been a dream since then, and it's still a dream today. I still have Hosoi skateboards, and we're still making boards. I've got my father involved again. He's working on some new graphics and shapes. Can I introduce you to him? He's with me right now.
It would be an honor to meet your father, Christian, to meet Pops Hosoi.
I want you to, you know, just say hey.
Drop me another legend here, Chris.
I just want to know what's going to happen. Just go real quick. Just say hi to him. You'll see your picture right here. This is my father, hi.
Hey, sir! Everybody, thank you so much for being here, sir! Thank you so much, sir!
And we're still around the hot pink, obviously.
Still around the hot pink!
We have these spandex now, but I'm going to bust my abs out. I tell my wife they're under there somewhere. I would say it's a continual proud, you know, pridefulness towards your children that needs to be unconditional. You know, he was talking about the ups and downs and through the strife and the struggles and the trials and tribulations. And I think that that's where true proud, being proud of your children really is. Because it's not when you're just doing good or you're performing right or you're acting right that parents should be proud of you. And that's the problem with society today, that parents think that you have to, like, perform for them to be proud of you. And if you're not... struggles that they tell you, you know what, you're no good, or they start speaking, you know, and I'm not proud of you, and I think that that can destroy a children, you know, your children's life, you know, and set them on a course of just being angry and ending up doing things that they will end up regretting later. But I think that's where stuff like this can inspire a group of people that may be going through that, may have parents that weren't there for them, maybe haven't, you know, had the best, you know, upbringing. But you know what? You can learn it by hearing our story and vicariously being encouraged that, you know what? It's not about, you know, just my earthly parents being perfect or loving me and supporting me like maybe my father did to support my skateboard career. But it could be just the unconditional love that you have for your parents. They have you.
Sorry, about the little Skype.
So two-way street.
Sorry, Chris. Skype was cutting out for a sec. Sorry, Chris. The last couple words, the Skype cut out for a hot sec. I apologize, brother. Let me just make sure it's all back. You know what it is? It just may be because we've been on for a bit. You know what we do, Christian Pops? I think this would be a good time, my scholars, to open up the floor for student questions. But ladies and gentlemen, again, what an honor it is to have Christian Hosoi and his father Pops with us. This is a blast. Because scholars who never like to jump up and get some questions going, feel free, any way you want to go with it. Don't feel bashful. Carolina, you feel free, kiddo. And if you want, guys, if you want to be on the camera so Chris can see you, just walk this aisle and you'll see that you'll be in the view of the laptop. Oh, yeah, Kat, you're good, you're good, sorry. Christian, this is Catalina. What about the students out there?
How are you?
I'm doing well. Nice to meet both of you. I actually have a question for you, Chris. And it is, do you believe that media has the ability to distort not only images, but people's lives, such as yourself as when you were a young celebrity, and also ours as consumers and fans?
Yeah, I think it can a little bit, but in the end, the truth is the truth, and you... What's the guy? It's always... can you hear me?
No.
Sorry, it's the first couple seconds got cut out. I apologize.
I can tell when it kind of skips a beat.
Thank you.
Are you good now?
Yes. Sorry, Chris.
I think there's an element they can try, but really, they're going to see who you really are through your example and how you live your life and how you perform. And it's kind of like a competition. Like, you don't leave it to the judges, right? Because then the judges can pick and it's preference. You know, it's subjective. You know what I mean? It's what they like. And I think that that's where, you know, for me, I always left no room for there to be even a decision to make whether I was doing what I wanted to do or I was who I was, you know, going to present to everybody I was going to be. And so... You know, rumors are rumors, you can't stop that. There's gonna be haters that are gonna try to spread a rumor about you in the media, because media it is at the helm. They kind of control what's being fed. But if you give them nothing but good stuff, what are they gonna pick?
Yeah,
so I try to just give them nothing but great stuff, and whatever they choose to push and show or promote or brand or anything, it's going to be good. May not be what I would choose because I'd be like, oh, this is way cooler or something. But, you know, for each, say, network, media, and social media platform, it's kind of cool to have that. Oh, it's an artistic way of presenting it to the public. You know, it's artistic in every form for media. Like me, I love media. I love doing all the media I can, and everybody's like, oh man, they're gonna destroy it, they're gonna try and change, and I'm like, let them try. But to me, it's fun, and I don't, you know, I'm kind of like thick-skinned and tender-hearted now. I don't get offended as easy as I used to. Before the day, you said something bad about, oh, I was gonna let you have it. There was no social media for us to let them have it, so you physically had to go down there. On social media, so everybody is like, you know, on pins and needles, having to like be careful because there's power in the media. And that was a great question.
Thank you for that, sis. Beautiful question, Kato. I got a question, I believe, that I can screw it. Hey, come on up, sis, please.
Not a real serious question.
No, any question at all for Pops or Christian, my scholars, any realm. This is Amy from the UK.
That massive ramp right back in the day.
What was that now?
You got to stand on that massive like ramp at the X Games, right?
Mm-hmm.
And back in the day, what makes you go up and do that each time? Like, I'm scared, like, petrified every time I watch it. So
well, it's like you going to that classroom.
What?
You know, for me, it's what you love to do, it's what you're passionate about, it's what's going to take you to the next level of where you're going. And for me, that's what I loved, and it was like, oh, this is another higher, bigger ramp, and I got to do a higher, bigger air, and here comes the Guinness Book of World Records, and I'm going to break the record, you know what I mean? But that was kind of like my goals, and I was aiming to do that, and I ended up achieving a lot of those things every time it came about, because that was my determination, and I think that when you're like that, you're fearless, and when you look at a big ramp, and you're looking down, I'm like, I'm going to be the first to do this. I'm going to be the risk taker. And I didn't do it just like blindfolded, like, oh, here it goes. I'm a superstar. I'm evil, right? No. I was like, no, I'm going to really focus on this, and I'm going to do it. And not only do it, I'm going to do it better than everybody else can do it. And I think that that's where, you know, not in an arrogant way, but I wanted to do things kind of like how Bruce Lee took things in, like, to the whole next level. He was so far ahead that no one's ever touched him still to this day.
Ooh, I like that!
That's kind of like what intrigues me about people like that. Bob wants to say something.
What's up? Hey, and so on your question, which kind of races off of her question, media, it's actually a similar question. That skateboarding is an American sport created, brought to the forefront as an American thing. And today it's going to be in the Olympics for the first time, and it
happens
to be an American ideal for students to be what they want to be, not only in skateboarding. But because America has a chance, even today in the world we live in, you know, you being young kids in school, you know, you're coming up to a big ramp in life, you know?
Nice.
And you take it, and you take the drop. And I think the fear of falling is not the issue, because in skateboarding, you don't fall, you fly. If you know the geometry of skateboarding, it's a centrifugal thing. So when you're pushing on the ramp and you're coming down, it's not falling flat like when you drop an egg to the ground. It's a whole different
ballgame.
And so it's a new thing. And I think you guys got a chance to do a lot of new stuff in this world, which the world needs. You know? It's like created.
Christian and Pops, you guys are amazing guys. Thank you for this.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is RJ. Thank you for sharing your time with us today, both of you. And my question is this. So in 10th grade, you guys decided to, you decided to pull him out of school. And today, luckily, you became very successful. However, at that time, what was your backup plan? Saying, for example, if you got an injury that would potentially not let you skateboard anymore, or I don't know, was there like hardships with the school? Because I know like they want everybody, like according to the law, like kids have to go to school. So how did all of that play out? And what was your backup?
There was no like homeschooling back then, and it was either you were a, say, actor and you had a tutor on the road with you, or there really wasn't anything like that because of, you know, the times. You know, this is 1982, 83, and we had to make that decision. And my mom, who was the secretary of Beverly Hills, she goes, Christian, your backup plan is you can always go back to school. She said, right now, you'll never be able to go back to where you are to fulfill the career and the dream that you have for skateboarding based on your performance right now, based on your talent and ability at the moment. So, because me and Tony Hawk were the youngest skateboarders there, doing what, you know, winning contests at the youngest age, and it's funny, now we're old and we're skating, you know, and now we're the oldest guys skateboarding, but, competition, and we're still doing this and that because we're pushing the boundaries. But at that moment, we had to decide, and she knew, and she was with millionaires, like people who owned big companies, and they're like, what? He's going to drop out of school to skate and pursue his career in skateboarding? They were like, that's amazing. Like that's an entrepreneur right there, and you guys support him, he'll be able to succeed. And so we started a corporation. We did things correctly, I understood business, and it became a family business, you know, where my mother was involved, my father was involved, and so it wasn't like I was just like, oh, go and, you know, be an artist in so-and-so city, and hopefully you do well. No, we had a plan. And after that, plan B was, I loved school, I loved education, but really, I would have probably been a UFC fighter. Or I would have been an actor, acting like a UFC fighter. Or I would have been in the billiards parlors playing pool, hustling people. And surfing as well. Surfing was something that was like, oh, I want to surf, I want to be the best. And I was like, skateboarding is way cooler. Sorry if you're a surfer in there.
I love them both, Chris.
Awesome.
Archie, great
Thank
question,
so
brother.
All right.
Great question, brother. You know, Christian and Pops, we got about another 7 minutes before we start wrapping class up, because by 2 o'clock, the students are off, and they're off to a brand new class that you have to attend. But I'd love to see if...
Can you stand in front of the camera?
Yes, because I'm sorry, brother.
Bunchy, it's not about you.
Good job. Come on up, brother. Core, I think your question was already taken, I heard. Right on, yes. Good question, Arch. Christian, one more question, sir. And this comes from one of our all-stars, Nathan. Nate, take it away, kiddo.
Hey, Christian. So I'm really curious about your journey as a Christian from when you first started skateboarding. I noticed the documentary, like you're wearing a cross around your neck sometimes with your shirt off. So I'm wondering like, how seriously you took Christianity and the Bible then, and then as you started getting drugs, and then into prison, and then into now.
Well, I never grew up in question. You never read a Bible. My pops is right next to me. He could testify to that. That we didn't, you know, we weren't really behind the scenes. No. But it was like, you know, here I am. My name's Christian. My nickname was Christ in 85. I invented a maneuver called the Christ Era. No one talked to me about God. No one prayed with me. No one stopped me in my tracks and said anything that would attract me to going to church or reading the Bible or praying
way before our food. I mean, I traveled the world, like, over and over. I hung out in Hollywood with the most famous people. I hung out with the most gnarliest street thugs on the street back in the day, because that's who we were attracted to. But no one I knew anything about God. And so here I am now, full-blown drug addict, and my girlfriend goes, you know what, Christian? I'm going to quit drugs and go to church. And I was like, sweet. You know, God's good. I'm good. Drugs are good. Me and you are good. As long as it's good, you go to heaven. And that was the place. So for me, I was all about karma. So growing up, I was all about giving, generous. I shared my drugs with people. You know what I mean? Stuff like that. I think I was a pretty good friend, and I thought that those were the things that would get me into a place called heaven. And so here I am now, landing in a prison cell, and I went to church for the first time with my wife of today, and I'm calling her, and I'm like, babe, I don't know if I'm going to make it 10 years in prison. And she's like, you know what, we just got to trust in God. And I was like, God, I need a lawyer. I need an attorney. I need a Christian, go get a Bible, and I've never read a Bible in my life. To think about that now, how can that be? A person of such, I would say I was street educated. I was, I traveled the world, and I did business. I thought I was a high level, person in high class places with some huge people, and I could relate, and I could talk with them, and everybody thought I went to college. You know what I mean? But here I am, thinking I know it all, to the point where I opened up the Bible, and it was like, boom, the scales fell off my eyes, and I realized that I was created for a purpose, and there was a plan for my life. It wasn't just for me to exist and to do Christ cares. It was for me to have a relationship with Christ, and that He loved me. And the whole reason for the Christ, crucifixion was that it was for Him to, die for. I mean, this is basic Christianity, 101 on those who call themselves Christians or those who heed to the faith of Christianity. And so for me, I was like, man, my name's Christian. My nickname's Christ. And if they'd ask me, are you a Christian? I'd be like, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian. I'm seen by the cross somewhere. My name's Christian. I invented the Christ there. You know what I mean? Like something that was tangible, that there was a God that was alive that created all this. And at that moment, when I opened up that Bible for the first time, it was like literally my heart turned into, it went from stone to supple and flesh into where I can really appreciate life. And that I was able to really realize that my life was influencing people. And that I can turn it all around by my choices.
And that it's not about what you've done that really is who you are. It's what you're going to do and who you are today. And so the past doesn't, discount my future. And so all of a sudden when I accepted Christ, it was like I was washed clean as snow. I was moving into my future. I had a new identity. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, all those who are in Christ are a new creation. When I read that, I was like, you mean all those bad things I did, all the things that I did, the abortions. I killed my own kids. You know what I mean? When I got a revelation of that, I was like, how can you forget that? But in His mercy, He forgave me because He realized that, I can't perform to enter into this place called heaven. It was Jesus that took my place for the sins that I committed on the cross, and that if I trusted that He did that for me, that I will be saved. So it's calling on the name of the Lord, you'll be saved, it says in Romans. And at that moment, I called on His name, and it was like all the guilt, all the shame, all the hurt, all the pain washed off my shoulders. I was set free by the power of His love, and I spent 5 years in prison, a free man for the first time in my whole entire life. Come on, right? Joy that skateboarding couldn't give me, girls couldn't give me, money couldn't give me, my family couldn't give me. It was like all of a sudden I knew I was there and there was a purpose. And I knew one day I'd be out
out, and I'd be sitting here doing things like this, talking to people, sharing my story. I'd be on the Subjective Perspective show.
Thank you, Rob.
There's hope, and if there's hope for me, and if I can turn things around, there's hope for anybody. And that's why I like to share my story. I like to tell people that there's, you know, second chance. You don't, you know, if you got breath in your lungs, you still got a chance, you know. Another question?
Hey, so for those of us who end up down in Orange County, well, I know a lot of us like down in Newport Beach or around there, is there a way that we can see you speak? Do you speak regularly at that church?
Say that again?
So do you speak regularly down there in Orange County for those of us who end up down there a lot?
Yep. Gotta come down. I serve at the Sanctuary Church in Costa Mesa. And come visit. You tell me, you remember that show? Saw you on that screen. You and your pops. And I'd love to meet you in person, but hopefully I'll come over and just be a person in the classroom up there.
We would be honored, Christian.
Yeah.
So, Christian, brother, we have about literally 4.5 minutes, but I would like to give you and Pops the total last couple minutes to lead the students wherever you would like. But also, Chris, I was mentioning this to you earlier, and a couple other of my students had mentioned the skateboard decks, brother, that I'm going to be buying from you. For anybody that might be interested, I tell my students, don't ever worry about money, but if anybody would really be interested in having a piece of your legacy,
me on social media. I do this for my fans, those that follow me on social media. This isn't like an eBay thing. I don't, you know, it's not just to raise money, even though I'm raising money. You know, I send my kids to private school. It's expensive. And so for me, if this is not to support my family, you know, like my father lives in Hawaii, I want to take the whole family to Hawaii. It costs a lot of money. If a board that I wrote in the 80s that maybe I've skated in a contest or it's in a picture in a magazine can help get us in and have that time, it's worth it. And somebody can have a possession like that that I think is you know, true. I mean, my father kept a lot of my memorabilia, which I never thought about it back then. We didn't think there'd be a collective or like a collection thing. But now I have such a huge collection, and it's really amazing to be able to share that with people. And so for me, it's through my social media. I always just post stuff up. I've got like a couple stacks that I'm selling right now. They're very expensive because it's stuff I've written. But then there's just stuff that, you know, I've had and wrote recently that I still, you know, get to bless people with. And it's still, you know, I'm either going to keep it or somebody can own it, and, you know, it's something that, you know, I've written. I think that if I saw Bruce Lee's nunchucks and they were for sale, and there was a new pair that he owned in a bag, I'd be like, I want the used pair. And for me, that's how I feel about his stuff, so I kind of look at it the same with my stuff, you know, but it's always cool to be able to interact with my fans that way. And let them know that they have that kind of access to me versus, you know, a lot of people where it's difficult to even get on a phone call with them.
Christian Pops, guys, we have about 3.5 minutes left, gentlemen.
Sure.
I'd love to give you the last word, and
I'll let Pops say something for a minute.
Yeah, you know, when he was born, we needed a name. When you get born, you need a name. Every hospital, birth certificate. I didn't have a name. There was this movie on, Mutiny on the Bounty.
Oh, yes.
You know, it's a famous book. And so I was going to name him Fletcher. And Fletcher wasn't good. So his last name was Christian. I said, oh, that'll work.
That's
and Christian. And the movie is someone who takes over the ship because it was a bad ship. So the name Christian had a good historical thing, and it comes from Christ. And not that I knew it, but I knew it had some kind of historical value. And a parent always does this. They look for a name that has historical future, not even knowing where you're going. So everybody's parent even if you're not successful in nailing you in a subliminal way to be successful, and even if you're not, the beauty is they tried, you know, with your serving. So I think it just so happened that Christian became real. And when he went to prison, it wasn't real anymore. It became, you know, like, how are you going to get out of that? You're finished. But then it led to the crucifixion of Jesus and then the resurrection. So we never planned that, but it looks hindsight. So everybody in life has got that, you know, everything just falls into place. And it doesn't have to fall into place to become a known person. You know, you have your wins.
Yeah, I like how he ended that because it's ironic how.
That's beautiful. And Christian, I'm so sorry, guys. We have a minute left before the students go to the next course. I want you to take us away, Christian. We love you guys.
Let me just finish. You know, what he said, it's not about success like a monetary place, it's succeeding in life and being a person with character, integrity, and morals. And if you have those things, you're richer than most people who are rich in money. And so I encourage you guys to always remember it's about your character, it's about your legacy, and your integrity. I love you guys, man. Keep studying. God bless you guys. I appreciate you.